Erica in the house.
Yep.
Do you go by just Erica?
Yes.
Because you have three beautiful names.
Thanks.
Say your complete name.
Erica Jean LaViolette.
LaViolette. Okay.
Yeah.
I didn't know if you went, it was just Jean or Jeanette. Or
yeah, well, that's actually my grandmother's name. So
Jean?
Yeah. Okay. And she spelled it that way her whole life.
Gotcha.
And then my sister's first name is Jean, and she spells it J-E-A-N, the real spelling. Because when we saw her our death certificate, we realized she had been spelling it wrong her whole life. So we my sister and I each have the name.
Okay.
The different spellings.
I like it. Louisville all your life?
No.
Give me your background.
I'm a transplant, but I've been here a long time, so it's home. I'm from Wisconsin originally.
Oh, yeah? Okay.
Came down around 2001.
Because?
It was after...
A guy?
Kind of. I just graduated college, and 9/11 happened, and it was really hard to find jobs at the time. So we were just kind of exploring and going anywhere. And we had a deal wherever we, you know, whoever got a job first, that's where we'd go. So we actually ended up in
Idaho
first.
So when you say we, you mean you and a significant other?
Yeah, at the time. Yeah.
At the time. So you, Wisconsin, and then he, I guess he gets, or a job comes up in Idaho?
Yeah, we went to Idaho first.
Yeah.
That was interesting.
How was
I was
that?
Like, oh, it's not like Wisconsin everywhere.
Yeah.
It was the first time I saw mountains, you know, been out west.
That's a good point. Yeah.
It was amazing.
Yeah. Beautiful.
It is. Yeah. I have itchy feet and I really want to get back out there.
Do you?
It's been calling me again, yeah.
So you go from Idaho to here? Or?
Well, yeah, we went back home to Wisconsin,
okay.
Ran out of our graduation money.
Yeah.
ended up in Indiana.
Okay.
And then kind of just started moving our way down south.
Gotcha.
We were getting joked on, like, by the time we retire, we'll be in Florida.
I mean, that's kind of how a lot of it happens for a lot of people. So.
Yeah. But, yeah, I really like it here. It's not something I would have, like, placed my finger on the map and said, I want to go here and be here. But
well, what made you come here? Work, or was it?
Yeah, he got the job first.
Okay.
Came down 2 months later, and I actually got a job the next day. And,
oh, well,
just
there you
kind
go.
Of been around the area, be bopping around ever since.
How long have you been in Louisville now?
So I think it's like 18 years now.
Really? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So yeah. More than half your life.
This is the longest, yeah.
Okay.
Because I've been around a lot, but I really like the people here. I connected with people really quickly, and I like the artsy culture here, the supportive artists and independent businesses and things like that.
One thing that I've really gravitated to is the art scene and arts and, you know, film industry. I mean, later on, actually, the next guests into burlesque and that stuff. And then, you know, with your dancing, I mean, it is very, very creative, a lot of talent involved.
Mm-hmm.
And it's something that I've really come to enjoy and appreciate a lot more, and I try to get out and see different these things that I normally don't go out to, or a burlesque show, or, you know, films, independent films that a lot of the what I've come to find friends are involved with, and I just, you know, you just a lot of that kind of pop culture thing. I don't know, for some reason didn't gravitate to it locally. I always saw, you know, that kind of stuff, big city kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a lot of stuff like that going on here.
Yeah.
So, and you know, with my guests, we cross paths on Facebook, you know, for whatever. And I saw the things you're involved with. Belly dancer.
Yeah.
And yoga.
Mm-hmm.
And is it Reiki?
Reiki.
Mm-hmm. Reiki. I want to know all about it. Because I take pride in being someone that I think knows a little bit about a lot of things. And I always want to know more. And that's kind of why I do this. So
yeah, well, that makes sense.
well, tell me, you're in Louisville. You come in Louisville. Is this what you're doing now with the dancing? Is that you did this? You know, this happened after you got to Louisville, or had you been doing? Okay.
Yeah, actually, I just kind of freestyled my whole life. grew up in the 90s, going to the rave scene and all that. Yeah. And I just have this passion for dance. I didn't really have any type of lessons or anything till actually, like, after I hit 30. I don't know what sparked it. I think it was because I started taking yoga, and I started really getting into alternative health, and right. made me more exploratory to, oh, what else is out there? Mm-hmm. And I just happened to take a belly dance class during a yoga thing, and I was just like, oh, this is really interesting. And I never thought I would have landed where I am now. I was just open, you know, and just following my heart. And it just kind of, over the years, I got, tried to get that improv mixed in with the technical mm-hmm. aspect. And that it took a while for integration to happen.
Right.
But yeah, once it did, it's, then you just kind of put your own flair on it. And now I'm just, I don't know, I love it. I'm really grateful that I've had the opportunities I've had so far. So
not only are you with the belly dancing, the fact that you're dancing as in a dancer, you're also now a teacher as well. So you've been, correct? You've been,
yeah, doing, I teach.
So I guess, why belly dancing? I mean, because, okay. well, first of all, I think dancing, when it's done right, it's one of the most beautiful, sensual, we said that word before, mm-hmm. Sexy. I mean, it is, I thoroughly enjoy watching a woman dance. I just think it's very, there's nothing, you know, no bad thoughts to it. It's just, I found it very engaging, sexy, attractive, and so.
Yeah, I think there's something to be said when someone is just in their element, they're in their zone. Like, I view my body as an instrument, and, you know, even though, like, I'm in the band, Suzu, they're all playing their instruments. I'm like, oh, I'm playing mine, too, just in a different way.
Mm-hmm. That's a good point. Yeah,
yeah, I actually fell into it because I had back issues, and I wanted to strengthen my core.
Uh-huh.
So that's what got me started into yoga, and then kind of I was like, oh, well, belly dancing, like, I, you know,
right.
you're totally using all those muscles, so... It has helped me a lot, and then it's also helped me more than just the physical. I became, like, more self-confident, more empowered.
You touched on earlier before we started that you're an introvert.
Yeah. I know.
I know. Is that more of an excuse to get out of doing things, or, you know,
no,
but I just don't find, how can you be that and still perform what you perform, and that I'm not registering. Help me understand.
Yeah,
that
it took a while to be able to be comfortable in front of people. Mm-hmm. My dance company helped me with that, because we would have little student showcases, and I kind of got over some body shame issues, and you start seeing people in all ages, all shapes, all sizes, and they're just out there because they love it.
People
so much.
Body shaming you?
Well, just for myself personally.
Oh, okay.
Like,
okay.
I had to overcome showing my belly. Like,
oh,
I my whole life,
okay.
I kind of,
okay.
like, covered it up,
okay.
you know.
All right. But you're so petite.
Well, we all have our issues.
Okay, fair enough.
But, yeah, this helped me work through a lot of that. I really took it to heart growing up, trying to fit that image and not being the certain image in my head that I was told myself I needed to be. Mm-hmm. So it helped me break that mold, which is awesome. Mm-hmm. And it's just a sense of community and just being around other women, you know, helping each other out and just wanting each other to grow and just having fun. And you get together and you have your performances and you have your costumes. It's creative that way too. It's a creative outlet.
Right. Yeah.
You get to sew your own costumes, put your own look together. You get to, mm-hmm. you know, explore choreography and learning different
right,
things.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Very it takes some creativity to definitely do this. I guess, you know, I get it, but how the belly dancing still, I'm how does one kind of just fall into that? Or because I don't readily see that out there. I mean, when I saw you and all the stuff you're doing, I'm like, yeah, that really does happen.
Mm-hmm.
Is it like an underground kind of thing, or is it, I mean,
I think it's gotten more traction lately, mm-hmm. especially with, like, the festival scene and just women in general. I think there's, like, this movement, you know,
oh, yeah,
women empowerment,
yeah.
and It's just things aren't as taboo anymore, and there's more understanding.
I'm glad about, and happy for that.
Yeah, women just want to be free and explore their own bodies, explore their own soul, you know, just do something for them. And that's what's awesome about this. And there's not a lot of, since it's ethnic, there's a whole bunch of different cultural things around it. There's not one thing saying you have to be a certain way. Right. So it's just very accepting dance, you know, and it's fun.
Yeah.
Like, you just get hooked. You go to classes, you'll go, you can go with girlfriends or go alone, and then just, you know, it's really awkward as hell when you're first starting because you are using isolated muscles you'd never used before. But once it starts to snap and you start to get it, you just get more inspired. And when you, like, you have an inspiring teacher, like my teacher was Isamura Gamari. And, you know, every time I see her, she's just always doing something different. And just being around inspiration makes you want to be like, oh my gosh, she has a new prop, I want to do that now. Like, or, you know, I've seen this and I want to try that now. Yeah. And so it's just been this course of following my heart and curiosity and just still having fun along the way.
Well, I mean, it's a nice segue that you mentioned, you know, parts of your body. And I'm curious because, you know, when you think belly dancing, you think it's you're focusing on your mid or your belly. But there's more to it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're using your whole body.
Tell me that process and how, what it's like.
Well, there's different styles, so you use your muscles in different ways. You can have a certain set of movements, but then do that movement completely different in the way that you isolate your muscles. So, like, Egyptian is more kind of loose, more traditional. You'll see, like, the bra top and the bedla, which is the beaded skirt and belt. And now there's, like, tribal fusion is really big, and everyone is fusing all these other dances, so it's kind of becoming this huge melting pot, which is awesome because people can express in all the different ways that they want to, and people cross train and then they put those movements into belly dance and it just incorporates well with
now,
with it all.
Is that accepting, I mean, what's the best way to put it, people who have been doing this, are they good with the fact that, you know, things are changing and evolving? Is that part of the process? I mean, I just think I have this vision of belly dancing and I see, like, the Hawaiian natives, you know, kind of thing. But it's evolved a lot past that.
Yeah, we've taken Tahitian and Hawaiian dance as well, hula. They're more about storytelling with their body.
Okay,
everything
that's a good,
is a story and it's like interpretation.
But that's part of your performance. You are telling a story.
Yeah, in a way. Yeah. Kind of the basics is, like I said, your body's an instrument earlier. Like, you use your hips a lot for percussion movements, and then you can use, like, your arms and stuff for more lyrical things. So you interpret the music, like, on the scale as well as into your body.
There's a lot of choreographing with this, too, right?
Yeah, there's... With my dance company, it's typically choreography.
Okay.
And then with the band that I'm in, Zuzu Yaya, it's all improv.
All improv.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
And okay. I mean, over time, you kind of do it so much that you start to be like, oh, I really liked that movement or whatever. For the chorus, like, I'll probably kind of stick to some similar movements, but then I'm always...
So it's true to say you're moving to the music.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what I love about it.
Yeah. Well, tell me about that band, the Zuzu Yaya.
Yeah.
What is that? I love that. First of all, where did that name come from?
Well, it's really interesting timing, but it started out as a Dr. John tribute band, and so they did the Night Tripper album, and so the Zuzu is part of the voodoo culture that was part of that era that Dr. John did. And he had belly dancers, so they wanted belly dancers.
Dr. John is in...
He just passed. So we're kind of like, oh. That's interesting.
Yeah. I didn't know there was an affiliate. So there is a tie to him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, they started out just doing the Night Tripper album.
Gotcha.
And... we all just kind of came together and said, you want to do this? Sure, I'll come to, you know, rehearsal and we'll figure it out. And it just all came together. And then over time, they started writing their own music. But they still do, like, songs from that album.
Okay.
And
Okay. Give me a instruments, how many people are involved, and what are we talking about?
There's a lot. Yeah. I think we're up to 13.
Is it?
People. Wow. Yeah, we kind of crowd into small spaces, and you wouldn't know it until we start. It's like the clown car. They start walking off the stage. Yeah. But yeah, there's horns and bass clarinet and guitar and different types of drums and percussions. And I mean, you name it, there's, it's like a New Orleans style band.
That's 13 musicians, but collectively.
I think collectively all of us is about 13.
Okay.
I'm a dancer, and then there's another dancer, but she also is a musician in the band. So we kind of take turns dancing.
You're only a dancer. You're not. It's the cowbell.
Oh, you do that. Actually, no, it's called, they gave me the coconut.
Coconut.
There you go. Right. I can do percussion, you know, I can keep beating.
Well, I'm just saying, let me go backtrack a little bit. The fact that I made a comment about enjoying watching women dance, they still have to do it to the beat. They have to maintain the rhythm. You know, if they're not doing the rhythm thing, I've lost it.
It brings it all together.
It does. Now talk to me about the Zen Den. What's that?
That's just what I call my front room in my home.
That is?
Yeah.
Okay. I like that.
I just do private dance and yoga lessons out of my home.
All right, gotcha. And yoga. The Reiki? Tell me about what is that about?
So Reiki is an alternative type of healing. It deals with energy.
Okay.
So Reiki is Japanese for universal life force energy. And it's a technique that you can use. It's like a laying of hands. And it reduces the body's stress. And it helps with healing. I don't know if you're familiar with like the energy centers in our body, like the chakra system.
No.
You have 7 main ones down your spine.
Okay.
And then you have all sorts of different ones throughout your body. So you can kind of think of it as a superhighway of how your energy flows in your body.
Mm-hmm.
And so with our culture particularly, we hold on to things. We hold on to stress. We don't really know how to let go. Mm-hmm. And that can manifest into, disease. And so
a lot of fallout from that. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Reiki helps with relaxing and helping to...
Is this a type of meditation, kind of, or what?
You can meditate. Okay. Like, you'll sit on a table for, like, an hour, like a massage table, but there's not massage touch.
Right.
It's just the Reiki flows through my palm chakras into the other person, and it helps clear their energy field. And some people might have release if they had a blockage. Like, sometimes they'll cry, or sometimes they'll laugh. Sometimes they'll just fall asleep.
Mm-hmm.
But it helps aid healing, and it's getting more research, and people are doing it, like cancer patients. A lot of nurses are getting their Reiki certification because it's helping people with pain management.
Mm-hmm.
So it is gaining traction, and it's getting out there. But I went to a certification, and it just totally changed my life. Like, I use it every day.
Do you? That's interesting. I do need to research more about that. Like one of the, on your Facebook intro, you've got the obviously goofball, which is introvert. I'm gonna try to get really the goofball. But I like what you see is what you get thing. What do I see when I'm seeing you? Tell me what I see.
I don't know what you see, but I can tell you that I am an open book. I'm an honest person, and people they feel comfortable coming up to me and talking to me, and I think it's just one of my gifts. I think that's why it pairs well with Reiki and people who are coming who are needing some assistance or helping or healing. I'm just me. It's basically what that is. Like, I don't try to put up pretenses or anything. And if you want to get to know me, just come talk to me.
Just come talking. Getting back to your teaching, what give me I guess, is it one-on-one group, and maybe the processes, what kind of format, or
it's an ebb and flow type thing. A lot of things with dance is it's really hard to maintain the studio.
Mm-hmm.
So my teachers had to close hers, and we still go to her garage, and we're all dedicated because we know the quality of dance that's there, and we don't care where we're at. But so we've tried having campaigns and things, and we'll have classes for a little while, and then interest will wane. You know, life gets in the way. You know, people think it's fun and they want to try it for a while, but then sometimes they'll let life kind of come and flow over them, and they don't put it as a priority. So we've just kind of have to gauge, do we want to do it again this year? Do we want to try again this year? A lot of studios have the, you know, same issues, and I just kind of have been like, well, I'll just try private lessons, you know, and then I can do it on my time. And I kind of gone to this subscription format with yoga and dance where it's like, you pay me a monthly subscription. If you don't show, that's kind of on you.
Yeah, that puts the onus on them.
But sure. I think it also helps motivate them to want to like put it as a priority and come, you know. And so that's been kind of cool. And it's been great for me to explore. When you teach, you have to like interpret it through a different way, not just, you know, for me personally, I have to explain every movement now. And so it's been a really good growing thing for me too.
Let's get back to the belly dancing. which I do. I think it's very. I think the word we agree on is central.
Yeah. Well, you're definitely moving different parts of the body intentionally, and there. You know, there's different costumes and different people have different ways that they want to move their body in those different movements. For me, dance is when I'm just completely in the moment and everything else kind of fades away and I'm not in the past, I'm not in the future, I don't have anxiety or depression, I am just there and it's just me and the music and what I'm feeling in the moment. And
is there, I think we've talked about with belly dancing, there's all these ethnic, you know, styles,
influences.
Is there what's your go-to, or is there a preferred, or
I would say my preferred is called serpentine kind of style of movement. It's very like ooey gooey. Yeah, think of a snake.
Like, you might be the first person that's ever used ooey gooey on this podcast. I'll take it.
Yeah, your connection from muscle group to muscle group is very smooth and graceful, and but then you also can like pop and lock. So it requires a lot of, what's the word?
I toyed around with this and I decided not to put you on the spot, but there was a part of me that was very interested in having you give us some sample.
Oh.
Yeah, so I'm
well, I'd have to say come to a Zuzu show.
Yeah, there you go. Oh, nice comeback.
I'll be warmed up. And
you're more than welcome to come to the show. I'll give you all you want. All right. You know,
yeah.
Deal. I will do that.
Yeah. I'm actually recovering from injury, too. I haven't been able to move in
She's
the last
playing
2 months.
Her injury card on me.
No, it's true. And it's,
what happened?
It sucked really bad.
Are you okay?
I am okay. I am a lot better now, but I wasn't able to move or do yoga or anything for like 2 months. I had pulled something on my right side, my abductor muscle.
From performing?
No, actually, I was lifting up something heavy in my yard. So stupid, you know, but I didn't do it right. I thought I could cheat, you know, the one time and don't lift with your legs. Ever do that. Yeah. but yeah, so I'm trying to recondition, and we have a show in a couple of weeks, so I'm going to be coming back.
Full force.
Yeah.
You know, also doing some research too, I found that, you know, there's, you know, you kind of touched on it, the certain movements, percussive, fluid, and then the one is the shimmies, shivers, and vibrations. What's that about?
Okay, well, I don't know about the vibrations, but the shimmies is like a pretty standard movement. There's so many different kinds of shimmies, but it's a percussive movement. So it's typically with your hips, and you're driving them up and down. You can
fast.
You can do a slow shimmy.
Okay.
Or you could do like fast shimmy. I think you're thinking of shimmer is where you kind of lock up and then you kind of shake and vibrate a little bit. You're not as loose. You can have shoulder shimmies. I can show you shoulder shimmy.
That's about all we're gonna get from you. Well, here's I'm looking at it, it says. Small, fast, continuous movements of the hips or rib cage, which creates an impression of texture and depth of movement. Shimmies are commonly layered over other movements and are often used to interpret roles on the or Rick RSQ or fast strumming of the oud and
oud.
Oud.
That's a musical instrument, yeah. It's a stringed musical instrument.
I might have to edit that. I usually don't edit. That was embarrassing.
Well, it's a Middle Eastern instrument, so, and it's a very beautiful one. That's more for like drum solos. You mm-hmm. have drumming and the oud plays, and you can do like what's called taksim. So the dancer is interpreting the music, and it's all improv. She's improving, they're improving. And
that is going to be in my head all night.
No.
Oud out.
Oud. Yeah. So, yeah, there's a lot of layers involved. Right. So once you get into muscle isolations, then you start to like layer those movements over each other, mm-hmm. and that's what makes it really, really hard. And that's how you can tell the level of performer or dancer, you know, one with their props, and also like how many layers and how much control they really do have over their body. You're not just kind of like out there sashaying around, you know. You are. Everything is very intentional and interpretive. And
there is some of that, though. As you just put it.
The sashay. That again.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, everyone has their own influence on it. It's so funny, if you look up different dancers, there's all these set movements within belly dance, mm-hmm. but everyone will have their own kind of flair on them, you know? The way that they interpret that movement and how, and depending what kind of music, too.
There's also the, with it, belly dancing is, they mention two distinct social contexts. A folk or social dance, and performance art.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, folk is more like if you're at a wedding, and the movements are very loose, and anyone can do them. You know,
wait,
the whole family.
A wedding.
Comes. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. It's originated from folk.
Okay.
Kind of dance, and now we've changed it to a classical form of dance where you have certain movements. Like there is, like tribal style takes flamenco. And mm-hmm. so you have various specific arm movements. Like your arms are like way up high. Your arms are on like a tabletop. And it hurts after a while. And all your movements are, and you are in a back bend position as your neutral.
Mm-hmm.
So that's very classical because it's very hard. Like it looks really easy, but it's not. Whereas folk, you're just out there and you can be loosey-goosey and do kind of those movements more like you're at a wedding.
Mm-hmm.
I should probably kind of send you some
I would love
different
that. Yes,
like
please.
Links, yeah. Different styles. And
or do you have readily have videos of you doing all these things? Or?
Yeah, of Zuzu Yaya has some videos up.
Well, I'm, what I'm getting is of you because, you know,
yeah.
with the podcast, it would be cool to add some video or links to that showcase you.
There's YouTube. If you search my name, you can find me under Samovar Dance Company, and you'll see all, you know, all the dances we've done at our student showcases and things. And then Zuzu Yaya has, we had a videographer at a show we did at Headliners, which was really awesome. He had one of those moving photos or videos, and he did a compilation of me too. That was really nice. But yeah, you can kind of get a feel. That's just improv and totally not traditional.
Right.
Fusion.
Fair enough. You know, a lot of it, I think we've touched on it, there's a lot of influence from different cultures and, you know, what's the word I'm looking for?
Like the different styles.
Yeah. Yeah,
there's Egyptian and Turkish.
Yeah, right.
And, yeah, Lebanese.
Is there an American style?
Yeah, it's American Tribal Style, ATS. It's more of a group improv dance. So you have a certain set of movements. And there's a certain set of cues. So once you learn those, the idea is you can go anywhere. And if you see another tribal dancer,
mm-hmm.
you can improv together and dance and look like you've practiced because you play off each other with the cues. So whenever they have like their style of dress is different too. They have a lot of layers and beads and They have zills that they play finger cymbals a lot. And so, yeah, and there's like different formations, and you can kind of solo out and things, but the whole idea of it is that it's improv. Mm-hmm. And so that's fun.
Is there a type of belly dancing that when you're dancing, you're losing clothing as you're doing it up until you get to a certain, you know, I guess your, you know, outfit, like your, I don't know if it's scarf, you know, types of.
Well, there's like the veil pop. You typically can enter kind of covered in the veil.
Exactly.
And then, like, you'll have your reveal, and then you play with your veil prop.
Okay.
But there's no, like, it's not anything like burlesque where you're taking anything off.
Right. But that, I think that's what I was getting at. I guess that's what I'm
thinking. But with Zuzu, I will, like, change costumes or skirts or layers, you know, just for the different effects.
Well, elaborate, too, on costumes. I mean, what's, is there different costume styles for, Egyptian, is there?
Mm-hmm. I mean, yeah,
so
definitely.
There is a. How, can you elaborate on
so,
that?
So, with Egyptian and Turkish, you'll see like the typical bra and the belt, and they're very beaded, and you have like the skirt. So, that's kind of more traditional. The belts differ, like one will dip down and one will be straight across.
Okay.
When you get into like American tribal style, you'll see all these skirts and. Like, they'll wear the bra top, too, but they'll wear cholis, and they'll get real tribal makeup, and they wear, like, big flowers in their hair, and they like to swish their skirts around. And then, like, with tribal fusion, kind of anything goes. Like, some people like real... like, I have a skirt that's very fitted, because your movements aren't all over the place swinging. You're, like, very isolated and kind of more serpentine. And so sometimes some... women even wear like pants, or you got your hair in pants, or
really?
Yeah, there's a lot of different kinds of styles.
I wouldn't have thought that.
I kind of like depends on what prop I'm using. Like if I'm working with veil, I don't want a whole lot of like tribal jewelry on that will catch on it, or like a big headdress. You know, tribal fusion is great, but you get these headdresses you make for a, you know, effect. And yeah, you don't want to be doing that with a fast dance, because then you could fall off or whatever. So there's all of those kind of little nuances too.
You kind of touched on some of it for the health, and you mentioned like the spine. But how much, I don't know, exercise, you know, does belly dancing, does the body good? I mean, is that fair to say?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's well-rounded, because one... you are isolating muscle groups, so you're building tone. And then when you're improvising and like getting ready for a show, and you're constantly doing the songs over and over, you're getting your cardio in. And then also there's a lot of like yoga to warm up and cool down, so you're getting a lot of stretching, a lot of flexibility. There's a lot of flexibility in the spine that you work towards with back bends and things. So you have to really, you learn to really engage in your body and know to listen to your body and not to try to extend and hurt yourself. You have to know when to kind of pull back and just accept where you're at and keep working, you know, little by little. But yeah, there's balance involved. You're balancing swords and candles on your head and things, and...
is that part of your act?
Yeah.
You do that?
Yeah, I do.
Yeah.
I like the sword a lot.
The sword?
Mm-hmm. I have a couple swords.
Really?
And veil and fan veils, those are probably my three favorite.
But what's the difference between that and Persian dance? Does it...
I'm not sure.
Okay. We can skip that, so...
Yeah, I've been studying like Turkish and Egyptian American tribal style serpentine fusion.
All right.
And then we've had different dancers come and go who have instilled like modern dance or jazz or, you know, kind of fun fusion things.
I'm sure with the fact that you're with this band, I mean, you all are working hand in hand on finding the right music to enhance your dance. So.
Yeah, well, I think my dance kind of is just helping to, it's just, I think the band is all about...
Or is it the other way around?
Yeah, I think the band is more about the experience between the crowd and the band. And so it's not just a listening thing.
So they're playing more off you. Is that what you're... Mm-hmm. Are you saying that? The band is kind of playing more off you than...
Oh, no. They play their thing, and then I just... You know, Romana and I go out and we just improv and interpret the way that we want to. And it's always...
So the band is still the, I guess... the core of the
they are in reaction mode. They practice like 3 times a week for 3 hours a day, and I just show up and dance.
But I'm doing the hard part.
Well, yeah, I do. It is like hot and
I look like
a drowned rat at the end of the night.
Yeah.
But no, the thing is, everyone has really great energy, and we all just work together and have fun. And at the end of the night, everyone's just pumped up and like, yeah, that was awesome. And we're all really supportive, and we're all happy that we do it, that we continue to do it. And we always want to instill that energy in the crowd, too, and make it an experience. Like, we have someone who does, like, interpretation for the deaf as well. Like,
oh,
it's
really?
Just, yeah, very all-inclusive.
that's interesting.
Yeah.
Huh. Wow.
And they just came out with their own album, too. We have a record we just came out with.
Really?
Yeah. So it's exciting.
Good. Oh, well. What's, I know you guys are probably not, there's other belly dancing companies here in town.
There's quite a few.
Yeah. There's a lot, probably a lot more than I would imagine. So I'm guessing, it's not such a secret or
I know there's actual studios, like they're not a lot of studios because that's hard to stay open. I think
did I read or see somewhere, right, even the YMCA offers?
Yeah, I think they did. And then Romana teaches classes too, and like in fitness type environments.
Mm-hmm.
Because people are realizing like if they're not a gym goers, like, there's a way to try to stay in shape, and it's fun. Like, you don't have to be a gym rat or anything. Mm. Or you just bring a bunch of girls, and, you're having fun with your friends and still getting a workout, And it's also really great mentally, because if you're learning different movements and ways to move your body, you're creating new neuron pathways in your brain, and it's really great for your brain as well. Like, memory exercises and learning choreographies and constantly changing that aspect as well.
Is there etiquette? Is there no-nos when it comes to this? What are the do's and maybe don'ts without crossing the line of, I don't know, the word decent, indecent?
There's a lot of people taking it into different forays. Mm-hmm. And it's not to say that that's right or wrong. It's just their interpretation. But I think it depends.
But etiquette, in the spirit of belly dancing, is there an unwritten rule that you shouldn't go there with,
Well, if you start to strip, that's not belly dance anymore.
Right.
That's burlesque or strip tease, the belly dance, there is a certain etiquette because there are certain movements that are the core of belly dance.
Mm-hmm.
And there are the certain types of costumes. And then there's the fusion realm.
Mm-hmm.
So the fusion realm is where kind of anything can probably go,
And that's accepted. Here's what I'm getting at is that, with it so culturally driven, my mindset is that there's an established way of certain ways of belly dancing.
There is. If you go and look up different styles online, you will be able to tell.
So those cultures, if they see something that's just totally a little more over the top, do they frown on that, or do people?
Some people do. I mean, I wouldn't call it belly dance at that point.
Fair enough.
I would call that whatever they're doing.
Yeah. Not belly dance.
Because there is.
So then you really don't.
Belly dance is folk and it's classical.
There you go.
That's a
good way to put it. Is like. Well, I'm not even going to talk about that because that's not belly dancing anymore to me. So I don't care what that is.
They can do whatever they want to do. It's not good or bad. It's just what they're doing, But, there are lines that would say that's not belly dance anymore.
Do you find after a performance that more times than not, you're satisfied with your performance?
I am until I look at the video.
Well, let me go back. Before you look at the video, you're basing the audience, the reaction.
Yeah, it's more, like I said, I'm more internal, and I need to be better at being external and viewing the audience.
Because you did touch something, you're kind of in this bubble, right?
Yeah, if you look at a lot of my pictures, I'm looking down and I'm very inward.
Yeah.
I'm working on more my performance aspect, my facial features, and mm-hmm. trying to be like, oh yeah, there's people watching me.
Like no time during your dancing do you do any of this stuff, like look at me, you know, smile or...
You know, I'm just kind of in the moment, and yeah. if I see someone who wants to, like, who's friendly, and like, I'll go up to them and maybe flirt a little bit, like, you know, whip my little veil at them or whatever. Like, it is flirty, you know?
Yeah, it is.
It's fun. Mm-hmm. It's mostly if I see friends or people I know, I'm like, oh, hey, you know, and I go over there and kind of flirt with them a little bit. I did a private birthday party once, and it was all women. And
for little Johnny?
No. it was all women, and they were just like... really supportive, and some of them really got up and they started trying to do the movement, so I'd go over there, you know, and it's kind of like a way to connect with people.
Absolutely.
If they want to connect that way, and you just kind of feel the crowd, like mm-hmm. if some people are just kind of not paying attention to you at all, you don't want to go up to them and try to be like, hey, look at me, you know. But if you see someone's really like happy and engaging, like
right.
I'll feel more comfortable to be over there and kind of be like, hey, what's up, you mm-hmm. know.
So you're not so much of an introvert.
Well, if I'm doing something I love and I'm dancing and I get in, but
you're
like
in
I
your
said,
element.
I'm in that moment, yeah. I'm in that element, then yeah, like my defenses fall away and I'm just there in my passion. Mm-hmm. So you wouldn't think I'm...
Tell me something else. What are you passionate about? Something else besides dancing?
Besides dancing? I like alternative health and healing, mm-hmm. which is why I like the Reiki. Mm-hmm. I think our society doesn't have enough options. It's not doing enough. I think we have like a mental health crisis going on, and
I would agree.
I work in healthcare too. I'm in graphic design and mm-hmm. marketing and things, and for my whole career. And you know, I think they're starting to turn the corner about that and looking at health and wellness as the whole person, your mind, body, and spirit, and not just pills. You know,
right.
But we still have a long way to go.
Very
so that's cool. something I'm passionate about. And how food and herbs are medicine, and you know, I think there's just other ways of researching and being and doing before we...
What's your take on cannabis?
I think it should be available for people. I mean, there's so many studies that it's helping people with pain and cancer, mm-hmm. and kind of like the Reiki, where people are like, what's that? That's crazy. I don't mm-hmm. believe in that. It's like, well, try it.
mm-hmm. Have you? Do you dabble? Do you use it? Or do you...
The cannabis?
Yeah.
I have it. I can't do it too much. I'm allergic to smoke, so I can't smoke anything. But
the oils or
I've tried the CBDs. I've tried a little bit of edibles, like with my back issues, mm-hmm. and that's kind of my preferred.
Right.
I'll do that if I'm really hurting, and it just helps lift my mood too.
Yeah.
It helps me feel more open.
Mm-hmm.
I believe that that's coming. You know, there's a wave happening,
yeah.
and I think people are going to understand things aren't as taboo as mm-hmm. it's been portrayed, you know, in the past.
It's a freaking plant.
I know. I love
you know,
it.
For all you God
things.
Fearing people, you know, if you know, you believe in God, you know, God, then that's the product of what he created. So.
Right.
All right. This is this part. Last part is what it's a kind of a rapid fire round of shots is what I call it. First concert you attended?
Oh gosh, I think I was 13 and New Kids on the Block.
I sensed I was going to say that or NSYNC. So there you go.
Yeah.
New Kids. What's your favorite?
That's
New Kids
hilarious.
On the Block. You remember what was that? What was that one song that you had to hear at that concert?
I don't remember the song. I just remember liking Joey.
All right. You are a girl.
I had actually a Barbie doll of one of them.
Did you?
Yeah, I did. He had a little rat tail.
Rat.
Yeah, I know. Gosh, you're making me bring up some things I haven't thought of in a long time.
I'm kind of going along the lines. I have to say the first concert I took me and my wife at the time, we took our daughters to Hanson.
So oh, yeah.
I got into that bop thing. All right. Superpower. What would it be?
Superpower. I think lifting things with my mind.
Wow. Okay.
I always liked the X-Men movies, and I liked Jean Grey's character the most. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. If you were stuck in an elevator with a celebrity, who would that celebrity be?
Probably Zoe Jakes.
Mm.
She's a famous belly dancer, and Beats and Teaks is like my favorite band ever.
Okay. Pet peeve.
Lying. That. If I get lied to, I pretty much will not.
Again, a reminder. You'll never have to remember or forget it. How am I saying? Yeah, if you don't lie, you'll never have to worry about forgetting. Scars. Do you have any scars?
Scars.
Give me a good scar story. What was the one weird scar that you...
Oh. I don't really have many scars besides... I haven't... It's not a scar. It's an injury story. That's
okay.
Funny.
Sure.
I used to be into inline aggressive skating, and I used to do competitions and stuff when I was young. So I was at the skate park, and I went down this ramp, and my skate hit some water or something that was on the floor. And so I slid on my knees right into a box, a trick box, and like the whole skate park went, oh, and it was very
quiet. Painful.
Oh, it was very painful. I slammed my thigh into it, and I couldn't walk very
no
well.
No external injury from it, though? No wound?
Okay. Maybe that's what's going on now. but, you know, I don't know how I did all that stuff and hurt myself so much.
Inline skater. Yeah.
I guess I had a high tolerance of pain back then. But, yeah, they called me Gimpy the rest of the weekend.
Gimpy. All right. If you had access to a time machine, and you can go anywhere in the past.
Past.
Where would you go? You're only going to observe. Where would you go?
I've always gravitated towards like Art Deco and Art Nouveau art, so I'd probably go back to the 20s and 30s.
Yeah.
It's an interesting time. Yeah.
Very cool. Okay. Where can people connect with you, the band, your teachings on social media?
Well, we have a Zuzu Yaya webpage and Facebook page.
Mm-hmm.
I've got my Facebook page. I don't really have like a dance page, but we do have some of our dance company dance page. If anyone messages, like, we'll get pinged, but we're not very active on that right now. We went to India in February and had a performance there, and we've kind of been recovering from that.
When Gerald's next one of your next performances? I want to get to one of these.
Yeah, Zuzu, we have one of our album shows at Letter Song on the 29th.
This month?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
Where is it at?
Letter Song.
It's on...
I've never been there. I think it's towards New Lou or Butchertown area.
Yeah, it's in the... Yeah.
I've driven past it.
Yeah, okay.
But it's an all-ages thing. We're kind of promoting the album and stuff. And
all right, cool.
Yeah, that'll be...
Definitely.
We have a lot lined up, though. We're going to be at Gonzo Fest and Peep Fest and World Fest. And
y'all do any... How much traveling y'all do, like, outside of the area?
They've just done a couple, like, festivals within a few hours so far.
All right,
but,
cool.
Yeah.
Well, Erica, thanks for hanging out. I learned a lot. You're not so much of an introvert.
You gotta get me going.
Yeah,
I'm not the initiator.
You're drinking. Is that your go-to?
Wine? Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah, I like to have a glass here and there.
Here and there. Well, thanks for hanging out. It was good stuff.
Yeah, thanks
and
for having me.
I would definitely hope to come out and watch you perform.
Yeah, anytime.
All right, and see if she does stay in her little bubble. Don't look down. I'll be like, over here.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Thank you.